Really, what I look back on these 40 years, and it seems to me to fall into three phases, which I have come to refer to as my three technical incarnations. The first one was the semiconductor area, the second was power electronics, and the third is a concentration on teaching methods and this design-oriented analysis phrase, which you've already heard mentioned, and that's what I'm trying to promote these days. But aside from all the technical stuff, and I'm really not going to say much about that at all, many of you here, I suspect, may not be aware that music has been a large part of my life since I was a teenager. I went into the RAF. I had to do that before going to college because colleges were filled with the returning vets at that time. So you had to do your two-year national service. And my father was a school teacher, and I always swore that I would never teach. But my father, a few years before he died, and that was probably around 1972 or so. But when I went into the RAF, I did a course in radio and joined the station dance band. And I didn't want to get posted away from that, and so the only way I could get to stay on that station for my 2 years was to become an instructor, which I did. And so that was my very first job, which was teaching, which I never intended to do. Well, it was actually because of music that I got interested in electronics, because that was the beginnings of hi-fi. You, anyone remember fiber needles? You had to sharpen them. And you would barely get through one side of a 78 record before the point would break off. And you'd have to stop and resharpen. Anyway, that's how I got interested in electronics, and that was vacuum tube days, of course. And so I wanted to build myself an amplifier, and that's a vacuum tube amplifier. I was very proud of that, because I built the whole thing, including punching the chassis and crackle baking the paint on it. And it was actually the second amplifier I designed, although it was the first one that worked. Does any non-technical person here remember how a vacuum tube works? Anyway, Caltech decided they needed to get into the semiconductor field, so they came to interview at Stanford and made me an offer, and I said, well, I don't really want to teach, but it's only a 3-year appointment anyway. So that'll put off the decision again about what job to take, although they weren't lousy jobs this time. So I came to Caltech in 1955. That was the book that I wrote shortly after I came here. The title has already been mentioned. Those funny looking objects on the cover are two transistors. That's what they looked like in those days. They were discrete transistors. And the reason I wrote the book was, after going to that course given by Shockley, etc., and back at Stanford, I was totally on my own to try to learn something more. And so I read Shockley's famous book and his papers. The paper in which he invented the junction transistor is a classic, published in the Bell System Technical Journal, page 431, 1949. And trying to understand what Shockley had done, then this is the book that resulted from that. This was my translation of Shockley, for engineers, I hope, as a matter of fact. The key would be that almost every important turning point of anyone's life is the result of an accident. But that doesn't mean there's nothing you can do about it. And so being prepared to take advantage of accidents is the important thing.